Hey everyone, welcome back to Today in Tech. I'm Juliet Beauchamp. I am here with industry analyst and author Chase Cunningham. We're talking about deepfakes, so stick around. Chase, thank you so much for calling in. Really appreciate it. Calling all the way from DC, right?
Yeah, just outside of DC, out in the country. So it's isolated whether I like it or not.
Maybe for the best right now. So as I mentioned before, we're obviously talking about deepfakes, but who better to explain what exactly a deepfake is than you? So could you tell us what exactly a deepfake is and how they're made?
There's actually a variety of deepfakes, if you will. The one that most people are commonly referring to when they talk about deepfakes is the video versions. You've probably seen the stuff online where Tom Cruise's face is put onto Bill Hader and Schwarzenegger's face is put onto Bill Hader, or the Obama one, as everyone's really familiar with. But essentially what they're doing there is they're taking an image like the image of me, and they're using graphics capabilities to put another person's image over it. But because of the way that you're using the sort of AI and the machine learning back end, you can make it look very realistic. And that's the one most people are familiar with. The other types that are out there that are starting to show up more often now is voice fakes and read fakes. And voice fakes are basically where I take a recording of your voice, I use an imprint to build a model of it, and then I put other people's words on your voice and send it to folks, which obviously can be very bad. And then the last one is a read fake, which is using an artificial intelligence, really a machine learning engine, to generate fake text. And those are actually pretty interesting, seeing some of the stuff that those machines are able to come up with on their own.
Right. So a deepfake goes beyond an impression or even something that seems that like it's deliberately false. For example, in the case of read fakes, is the difference between a read fake and just something that someone wrote to be deliberately false is the fact that the read fake is AI generated?
Yeah, so I wrote about this in my book. Really, there was a researcher that came up with a read fake and wanted to see if he could input a whole bunch of Shakespeare and then let the machine generate a Shakespearean play. And it did. And interestingly enough, it was good enough that he sent it off to some folks and they thought that it was actual real Shakespeare, that had just never been discovered. And it was totally generated by a machine.
Deepfakes obviously seem like quite a big threat for, I mean, industries across the board. So what is the appeal of a potential bad actor using a deepfake?
So the real appeal there is, whether folks want to realize it or not, we kind of derive our perception of reality now based off of what we see online. I mean, if you think about it, you get your news, you get your video from YouTube and Twitter and LinkedIn and all those things. Well, if you're a malicious actor and you can't get an exploit or a hack to work, because network security is better than it used to be, the next best thing is to go after individuals that are C-level executives and those type of folks, and basically come up with a fake video or graphic or something that shows them doing something that is compromising. If you could picture, like the CEO of Ford Motor Companies saying something that was essentially hate speech, you could really cause detriment to an organization. And by the time they can respond, it's accepted as reality, and then they have to work their way backwards. So it's very damaging.
So do you see the use of deepfakes as sort of a way that hacking has evolved? I know in your book you sort of mentioned this as like hacking reality. Do you see it as the outcome of perhaps better security measures on an enterprise's part?
Well, so I think what we're seeing is that the old sort of exploits and malware have kind of hit their threshold. I mean, you can still cause some exploitation and damage with those, but this stuff continues to evolve. And where we're going to see this happen more in the future is if you're familiar with ransomware, ransomware, you hit a person's machine and then you basically tell them to pay up or whatever. Well, imagine if you came up with fake videos and imagery and text and essentially put that on someone's hacked Twitter feed and said, look, if you don't do what I want, I'm going to post this online to a million followers. And that could get really, really bad really, really fast.
Wow. Yeah. So what are the implications for this beyond an enterprise? I mean, the natural thing that I'm thinking of, it's obviously an election year here in the United States, something that here in the US we are acutely aware of, even with the coronavirus crisis ongoing, I would imagine that this could be a serious, serious threat for elected officials.
Yeah, that's the one that actually worries me the most. You know, corporations can kind of deal with this, but when you're dealing with something as dynamic as an election cycle, where there is a vested interest for nation states to cause hate and discontent, this is the perfect opportunity. And you know, the fact that these candidates live and breathe by what their perception is online, which comes from video and text, is a very, very open avenue for exploitation.
So if I'm the citizen and I see my elected official posting something that seems outwardly hateful and seems to cause some sort of large controversy, how can I tell whether or not it's fake? Isn't the sort of draw of deepfakes that, for hackers at least, or bad actors, is that they're really, really difficult to distinguish if they're real or not?
Good ones are, yeah, the good, some of the ones that you see from the, you know, less perfected agents are kind of comical most of the time. You can tell they're pixelated and you can pick up something's weird there. There was one a while back with Nancy Pelosi and another one with Hillary Clinton that was very quick to tell that something wasn't right. But really, when you're thinking about these type of things, I typically call it the rule of three. You know, take your information from three different sources, you know, and get it from something that you know and you commonly look at, something that you've never looked at and you don't really know, and then something that is totally orthogonal to the storyline, and then make a decision based on that. And if you do those things, while it may take you a little bit longer, you have a better chance of actually responding intelligently to the issue.
Right. But I would imagine that some people aren't going to necessarily take those steps to perhaps think critically, or sometimes it just seems just believable enough that they take it as fact. I would imagine that also with the use of social media, a deepfake video or any sort of other deepfake audio or readfake could spread rapidly.
Yeah, I mean, this is gasoline on fire, and all it takes is one person. I wrote about this too, about influencing the influencers. And if you're doing this intelligently as an adversary, you target someone that has lots and lots of followers that typically will respond at an emotional level based on the information they put in front of them. And when you get that emotional response, right, you see something, this is wrong, and then they go off and firestorm it out to the internet. It just takes off like a rocket ship. And you don't have to go after a candidate. You go after someone that is tangential to a candidate. Maybe their kids or someone else that's an influencer that's tied to them.
Right, and then it can become a bit of a dumpster fire, much like what's going on behind you right now.
Exactly, it's right there.
So let's say, you know, you've been deepfaked, and at first glance, it might seem like the people who are most at risk for being deepfaked, as it were, are politicians, you know, the heads of companies. But like you just said, it seems like it could be kind of anyone.
Yeah, the biggest thing here is to have a sort of a knowledge of what's out there that's relative to your persona, and to be able to respond. And it's one of those things where, and if you kind of look at what happened with the Pelosi and the Hillary Clinton and whatnot, and some of the others that are in that line, the response has to be very quick, and it has to be something where you are saying, like, this was not me. I don't agree with this. This is totally against my personal beliefs. It cannot just be something of, no, that wasn't me. Like, there has to be a vectored response to it, because you're combating an emotional response from the masses.
Right, and what can that response even possibly begin to look like?
I kind of put some of this as theoretical possibilities in the book, but I mean, you could imagine, especially with what we're going on now with COVID, I have this imaginary scenario of a deep fake showing up in a particular area where there is a lot of COVID cases, and some pharma organization saying, we have a cure, however, we don't have enough, and we're only going to give it to this group of people. And if you do that, I mean, can you imagine the fallout from that? And it would be instant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can imagine that would be, it would spread also just like wildfire.
I mean, you potentially could cause riots that might lose, you know, human life over something like that.
So do you think it's wise for people, enterprises, politicians, anyone who could be at any sort of risk for being deepfaked to have and plan out their potential response now?
Yeah, they should. And you know, this is one of those ones where I do a lot of work on Capitol Hill, and there's been some early, you know, conversations around how to combat this at scale. Honestly, those solutions aren't present in the market yet. But the reality of it is just like they have disaster planning and contingency planning, they should have some sort of plan ready for this when it does happen, because it's going to happen. I think there was recently a disinformation campaign around COVID where they were saying the U.S. Army was the one that built COVID and released it to the masses. And there were people already jumping on Facebook saying, oh, you know, the Army's doing this. It's all the U.S. against us. And this is a big conspiracy. And by the time logic dialed in on that, it was pretty far down the rabbit hole.
So I'm thinking now, as deepfakes, I have to imagine, continue to spread and continue to gain popularity. And I would also assume only become more convincing as AI and ML technologies advance. You are probably left with a public who's really skeptical, not sure of what's true and what's not. So, I mean, in some sort of perhaps dystopian as it may be future, I could foresee someone intentionally releasing a deepfake, something that is inherently false information, and a fake person portraying it and saying, nope, this is real, and then the public just doesn't know who to believe.
Yeah, so if you follow some of the nation state level directives around this, Russia basically literally says in their campaign guidance that chaos is the goal. That it's one of those things where they don't have to necessarily win by just degradation and eliminating the enemy. If they can cause enough strife and discourse and chaos, they still win by just the nature of people having to respond to it and continue to claw through that process.
Right. And in that way, it can seem that whatever goal the person who was being deepfaked was trying to accomplish is just, does whatever plan any someone or goal that someone is trying to accomplish immediately take a backseat once they've been deepfaked? Does reaction and denying a deepfake immediately come first?
I think it has to. If you you can look at what happened with Starbucks a little while ago, where they had the police issues with the ethnicity and all that, and Starbucks actually responded extremely quickly to it, covered the social media angles, and they were able to minimize the impact to the company based on that response. And then you look at some folks at like Wells Fargo and a few others that have had similar sorts of instances that kind of sat back and said, we'll just let this blow away. And the gasoline was already on the fire. And by the time they got to it, it was a raging inferno.
Got it. So I guess before I let you go, Chase, how we may have a lot of viewers who are C-level executives within their enterprises or have some sort of relationship to a high-powered person, and they might be wondering, how do I prevent a deepfake of me? Is that even possible?
I don't think you can prevent a deepfake, just like you can't prevent a hack, or you can't prevent yourself from getting sick, really. But what you can do is take intelligent sort of steps to make sure that you have an ability to handle it when it does occur and be ready to respond. This is one of those things where it is not a matter of if, but it's a matter of when and how bad. And if you have a plan in place and you follow it and you respond intelligently, you can probably deal with the fallout. The single worst thing that organizations can do is ignore this and then let it happen.
Right. Security is always sort of about mitigating risk, right? And never about completely solving the problem.
Yeah. And it's if you're able to respond to it, you might be throwing water on a raging inferno, but eventually the water will start helping out.
Right. So where do you see deepfake technology maturing and growing in the next few years?
I think that where we're going to continue to see this is the evolution of this, just like we saw with malware, where it used to be you had to be an exploitation engineer and a computer scientist to write malware and whatnot, and now you can just buy it and use it. The next iteration of this is going to be just like that, where this is going to become easy to get, easy to use, deployable. There's already some sites that are offering, I think it was like $5 to $7 an hour to generate deepfakes. You know, so it's going to become more prolific as those costs and as those technical requirements drive southward.
I have to also wonder what sort of efforts are being made to combat it. I've seen sort of reports of AI tools that, you know, instead of creating deepfakes, are really trying to search effectively to distinguish real versus fake. Is there any sort of promise in that?
Yeah, some of the early conversations at the, you know, grand level are around leveraging distributed ledger systems to kind of tag real videos and real images, and then anything else that comes out that is not is basically considered a fake until proven otherwise, which is interesting in its approach. But, you know, the other problem that we run into is the amount of information that we generate now on a given day is so astronomical. You know, how could you possibly keep up with that?
So, Chase, before I actually let you go this time, is there anything else about deepfakes that you want our viewers to know?
I really think that it's a concept that everyone should figure out, you know, how they plan to respond to it and understand the intricacies of it. And just like with anything in the security space, you should know how you plan to deal with it, not if it will be an issue.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Chase. I really appreciate it. This was super interesting, if not, as I mentioned before, a little bit concerning, but this is really great information for anyone, perhaps CSOs, CISOs, to help develop a plan now for response before they're the target of a deepfake attack.
Yeah, thanks for having me. And, you know, if you're really looking for the down and dirty on it, I happen to know somebody that wrote a book about it.
And we will certainly be linking Chase's book in the description below for anyone who is interested about learning even more really, really interesting stuff. It's the kind of thing that it's worth a read to see just how these deepfake attacks actually happen, more than we can cover in, you know, a 15 to 20 minute video.
Right. Thank you very much.
Thanks. And thank you all so much for watching this episode of Today in Tech. If you liked this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel. If you have any questions or comments about deepfakes, please leave a comment below. I'll try my best to get back to you. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time.